ערב טוב, שבוע טוב. It's nice to be home. Home, it's a very wide explanation. What's been the idea of home? The Gemara in Masechet Baba Metzia, we'll try to talk about the time now after Rosh Chodesh, now the week of the 9 days until Tisha B'Av. The Gemara in Masechet Baba Metzia starts with a very interesting statement. There is a pasuk in Sefer Shemot, ועודת עליהם את הדרך ילכו בה ואת המעשה אשר יעשו. And the Gemara explains that in English translation is to teach them the right way of life. And the Gemara says, ועודת עליהם זה בית חייהם, teach them to have profession, את הדרך, to be nice to each other, ילכו בה, to visit the sick people, ילכו בה, זה ביקור, ילכו חולים, בה, to go to a funeral, to make burial of somebody who passed away, ואת המעשה, we have to learn to listen to what the Torah says. אשר יעשון, זו לפנים משורת הדין. Meaning, sometimes you have to follow the Torah asks you not to be strict. If you want to be kind to a person, you have to give in. It's another mitzvah, meaning that halachically you don't have to do it, but you're doing it because you want to be, you have to be nice. It applies to husband, to wife, to father, children, mother-in-law, daughter-in-law, to be kind, even though halachically you're not obligated. זה נקרא in Hebrew, לפנים משורת הדין. And Rabbi Yochanan, who was a rabbi in Eretz Israel, he said a very tough statement. לא חרבה ירושלים, ירושלים was destroyed, אלא because שדנו בה דין תורה. People came to the judge and they say, we don't agree with each other, and the rabbi say, what is the law? And they did it. And Rabbi Yochanan says that this was the reason that Yerushalayim was destroyed. אומרת הגמרא, ילדים ידים, מגיסטר לדיינו, so what do you want? They come to the rabbi, they ask a question, the rabbi gave an answer, what's wrong with this? אלא, שהעמידו דיניהם על דין תורה, ולא עבדו לפנים משורת הדין. In order to, they had a chance to nullify many of Dinei Torah by not going to the rabbi, just between themselves. The husband and the wife, for example, they have arguments. So one of them can give up and say, okay, I'm sorry. No, but they go to the rabbi and they make a whole thing of this. So they come to the rabbi, they make a mitzvah. But we tell them it's better if you can do it yourself. זה נקרא לפנים משורת הדין. Yes. No, the concept is that not everything should be an issue. We have this tendency sometimes to take the small issues and make them big issues. And every minor problem becomes a big problem and a source of aggravation and frustration. This, and then when you need the help. So we ask you, you know what, try to go לפנים משורת הדין. The But still I want to understand with you what's so wrong if when I have a problem I'm going to a rabbi to ask his advice. Or why two people then do not agree with each other go to a third person to arbitrate. It's a very normal thing. And why should this be the reason of destruction of Jerusalem? We know until now why Jerusalem was destroyed. עבודה זרה, גילוי עריות, שפיכות דמים, שנאת חינם. Thank you. זה נקרא לפנים משורת הדין. Let's continue with a nice Gemara in Masechet Yoma to try to understand what is the point that we mentioned before. In Masechet Yoma, Daf Kaf Gimel, the Gemara brings a story that happened in Yerushalayim in the time of the temple. And they say like this, Tanu Rabbanan, Ma'aseh b'shnei Kohanim, in Beit HaMikdash, in the temple, there used to be few hundred or few thousand Kohanim every week come to work. Who would do the job? How would they do the job? They used to make lottery. But before, they used to call to say, we need two people over here, we need five people over there, people just come. And it happens after many years, a very interesting event, that somebody say, hey, we need a Kohen on the altar up. And somebody, and there was a big ramp, and they had to go on the ramp. To the altar. And two Kohanim, two young Kohanim, wanted to make the mitzvah. So they were running. And they're running together on the ramp, and everybody wants to make the mitzvah. Wonderful people, they want to do mitzvah, they want to come close to Hashem. And suddenly somebody saw that, one of them saw that his friend coming faster. So he saw a knife on the, so he took the knife and stabbed him. לפני משורת הדין. ותקע לו בליבו. It was the first time that in the temple of Yerushalayim, during the עבודת הכהנים, that somebody killed his friend. So Rabbi Tzadok, the Kohen, was standing on the stairs and he says, we are shocked. The Torah talks about if you find a dead person, we don't know who killed him. Over here we see that two religious people, Kohanim, in order to do mitzvah, one of them stabbed his friend and he's dying now. And everybody was crying because they were shocked. It was unheard of. It's a mitzvah, it's a synagogue, it's a temple, And then they called the father of the boy who was about to die, and they say, your child is dying. And he came when he saw him that he was still bleeding, but in a very, very tough situation. So, what should you do now? Call 911, call Hatzala, I don't know, do something, try to save him. So we say, oh, Baruch Hashem, my son is still alive. Take the knife out because I don't want the knife to be tameh. So he was happy that if the knife became tameh, if that person touched it, they have to kosherize it. So he was wondering that he says, we say, Baruch Hashem, take the knife out, because I don't want the knife to get spiritual contaminated. Lelametcha, to teach you, and this is the most important sentence in this event. שקשה עליהם טהרת כלים יותר משפיכות דמים. It was more important to the father that the knife would stay pure than his own son to die. If we try to connect these two stories, we see over here something that when people do not have the right understanding of the Torah, whatever they are going to learn, they're going to use against the Torah. Because they are missing the essence of the Torah, which is it what we learn over here. There is the essence of Torah, which we're going to talk about it in a few minutes. In order to make our life even easier, I will teach you another story that maybe will give us a better conclusion to all of us where we would like to come to this year. The Torah talks about, the Gemara talks about, when was the decree of the destruction of the temple, when did it start? And the Gemara talks about an event that happened many, many years before the temple was destroyed, before the Babylonian came and the Roman came. And the Gemara says the story of Usto. In Bukharan we call Usto is a master. He used to teach their workers and give them profession and marry them off. And so there was a big master, but he was a carpenter. And somebody came to work by him, a young person, and he worked for a few years, he became professional. But his master didn't know that this student fell in love with his wife. He didn't say nothing, but he was preparing to do something to get the wife of his master. So after a few years, when the student became his own businessman, so his master came and asked him for $10,000 loan. So he told him, "You helped me, you're not a young person anymore. I don't want you to bother. Ask your wife, she'll come to my house and I'll give her the money." So he trusted him, he knew this for a few years already. So he asked his wife, "Go to my student, he will give you $10,000. So he came home, so he told her, "No, until you came to my house, I wanted to be with my wife and children, and I want you to stay with us." And she said, "No, I have to go home." I said, no, stay with us, stay with us." And he was keeping her for 2-3 days in his house as a sign of appreciation. Meanwhile, he sent a messenger to the master, and he says, "I don't want to make Janga Nazir, I don't want to make problems, but something with your wife behavior is strange. She doesn't want to leave. She doesn't want to go to your house. I don't know what happened. Maybe she is." And he said, "Maybe she was seeing somebody," and he gave all kind of doubts to the master, just in order to separate this couple. And he came and he told to this master, he said, "I sent them very quickly, but she looked for excuses, and I heard that she was hanging around with a few boys." So he asked him, "So what do you think I'm doing with this guy? I didn't know she's kind of a bad woman." So he said, "If I were you, I would divorce her." He said, "But the ketubah over her, she has a lot of money. I'm going to pay her for the ketubah." So he paid him, he did him a favor, he paid him for the ketubah. And he divorced his wife. And after a few months, they told her, you know, because your husband was very kind to me, I'm ready to take you to my house, to be my wife. And then he called to his master and said to the master, you know, you owe me money, so come to work in my business. And the Gemara says that he was sitting with his wife, master wife, after they got married, and the master was working and serving them. And in this moment, the Gemara says, there was a decree to Yerushalayim to destroy, to be destroyed. Now I will ask you, on the paper, on the books, this assistant or this student is a tzaddik. Yeah. He helped his master, he loaned him money, he supported him, he was willing to save his wife, not to be in the street. He took him to work. Everything looks very, very, very good. What's the problem? He is corrupted. What I'm trying to teach you today? I'm trying to teach you today, there is a concept in Judaism, it's called Naval Birshut HaTorah. He is an evil person, but under the Torah frame. And this is what we call destruction. You remember the Lo Charvah Yerushalayim Lefnim Mishurat Hadin, what I was teaching you? Everything is kosher. But the essence is corrupted. The idea of the Kohen, he sees his son dying. Try to help your son. Don't worry about if the knife is kosher or not kosher now. So once, there was a goy. He came to Rabbi Akiva and he told him, I want to convert, but I don't have time. I have 60 seconds. Can you convert me on 60 seconds? Today we would stone this person, okay? Rabbi Akiva told him, I need 30 seconds to make you a Jew. That's all? Just 30 seconds. What is the essence of Judaism? Ve'ahavta le'recha kamocha. The essence of Judaism is to be able to take your ego, your stupid pride, and all your fantasies about how good and beautiful you are, and put it aside, and try to care for other people. If you understand it, then all the mitzvot that you are going to do and all the Torah that you are going to learn is going to be a part of building back Yerushalayim. But if not, you are going to take all the knowledge and use it against God, against yourself, against your surrounding, but you have the feeling that you are very close to Hashem. One of my people that I knew in Israel, that he survived the Holocaust, I told him, I'm going to now a different angle, but I think it's connected. I told him, how did you keep Shabbat he was in Auschwitz, and his job was to take the bodies from the crematorium after they burned it. So we say, he was 16 years old, 17 years old, and he say, we used to walking from 5 o'clock in the morning on Shabbat until 5 in the afternoon, taking the bodies from the guest chambers. But when we used to come at 5 o'clock, if Shabbat was ever at 7 o'clock, we used to keep 2 hours Shabbat. And these 2 hours we used to keep Shabbat, we used to pray Mincha, we used to make Suda Shlishit if it's something. This was our 2 hours. In the camp, he say, we had people like us that they say, if we violate Shabbat already until 5 o'clock, what's the use for these 2 hours, what is going to add? And those people, they left the way. They became not Jewish. They became not religious after. But we survive. Why? Because we say now we have 2 hours, even though we saw many bad things, we should not lose the excitement of mitzvot when we can do it. Meaning, of course, it's written that we are not allowed to walk on Shabbat, but sometimes when you have to, but the hours that you may keep Shabbat, at least do it. So it's not just the spirit of Ahavat Israel, is the excitement when you can a mitzvah, do it. I cannot forget, I found a prayer that somebody wrote in the ghetto in the night of Pesach, that the only thing that was left to him to eat is a piece of bread. And as the rabbi say, you're allowed to eat it, but it was Leila Seder. So he wrote a prayer. He said, Rebono Shel Olam, you know me that until now, every Leila Seder I used to eat matzot and wine. Now it's become lechem oni, the bread of misery. This has become matzah. I'm going to eat it now, but I want you to consider it that I ate matzah and I made the mitzvah of Leila Seder. This is the opposite of those who are going to say, it's written not to eat, so if we have to eat, it means it's the end of the world. But this is the concept to teach to a person to what he can do as a part of your being close to Hashem. But this is a side issue. I want to go back to the main idea is that our Torah, if it doesn't have the build of Ahavat Israel, of loving your neighbor, of loving your spouse, of loving the people surrounding you, so you can make a lot of mistakes. And I give an example that when I was a student, they told this to me, there was one of the biggest rabbi in Eretz Israel was the Chazon Ish. And one of his students came and told him, you know, Rabbi, today I had a miracle. What is the miracle? I came to my friend, he was giving a shiur in Rosh Hashiva, I was giving a shiur, and I didn't know that they pray mincha before. And I say it's become too late, so I left slowly the yeshiva and I prayed mincha, and thank God it was not sunset. So the rabbi told him, he said, you know what? Today, you killed the person. He said, what? You were shofech damim. You are a killer. He said, me, a killer? What happened? I just went out to pray. He said, see, in the yeshiva of your friend, is there 100 students, and you came to listen to the shiur, and you left. What did the student think? Why did you leave?
Because the
shiur was not good enough. So you humiliated publicly your friend. They will not listen to him as they have to listen to him. So he said, I didn't think about it. What should I do? He said, you have to pray twice arvit and not to humiliate somebody else. But when you are missing the point of Ahavat Israel and whatever you have in the agenda is just Sinat Chinam, so whatever you learn in the Torah is, will be just to say that how people are bad and how people are wrong and how people are... The Gemara is telling us that somebody once came to the rabbi, he said to the rabbi, look at our generation, everybody is not religious, everybody is bad, everybody is wrong, everybody is evil. The rabbi told to his student, go and check who is this person. And they found to know that his father and mother had problems over there. He was not a pure source. Because if you are using your knowledge and your energy and your Torah and your studies and not focusing loving your friend or yourself sometimes, you're losing everything. So it's become just a knowledge, but you don't know how to implement it to how God wants from you. So you can be very educated. You can be very doctor, lawyer, rabbi, it doesn't matter. But if you are missing the connection that everything has to be become with loving and caring for each other, so whatever the Torah is learned was in vain. And sometimes it's the Nikra, it's even with the opposite. It's going to use it and destroy other thing. There is, in order to make it sweeter a bit, I'll tell you what I mean in the, a certain of a funny story that I heard. There was a young yeshiva boy that he wanted to date. He went to his first date in his life with the girl. He never spoke to a girl in his life. So he asked the rabbi, "Rabbi, what should I speak to? What should I say? I don't know. What should I speak to her?" So the rabbi told him, "Women like three issues. Talk about her family, talk about food, talk about philosophy, and so he came to the date. He said, "Hello, hello. So what should I say now? About family. Do you have a brother?" He said, "No, I have three sisters." "Okay. Food. Do you like French fries?" She told him, "No, I like French fries." Third question. He say, "Philosophy, probably have philosophy. If you had a brother, would he like French fries or not?" His rabbi taught him three issues. He came to the date. He said, 1, 2, 3, and finished. Now the date is, it was a good date. What he is missing? He is missing the connection about what he learned and how to implement it. If you are losing it, it can be wonderful things, but it doesn't go. There was a rabbi that he wanted to teach his son to be his follower, to follow his way. But the son was not a smart person. So he told him, "Whatever I do, just repeat it and learn it." He was sitting next to his father, and somebody came and said to his father, "You know, I have a problem, this problem, this problem, this problem." So his father told him, "The rabbi, I wish you Hashem will take all this from you and grant you good life." So he said, "You learned?" He said, "Yes." So he left the rabbi, somebody came, he said, "I'm the rabbi's son, you can talk to me." So we say, God was very nice to me. I gained a lot of money. So give me a blessing." He said, "Hashem should take everything from you." He said, "Why? What did I do wrong?" "Because my father taught me to say so." But if you don't understand the situation and you make all kind of statement, even though somebody taught you to say so, you are missing this connection. And sometimes we're missing this connection. So what do we say? We hide ourselves behind the Din Torah. The Torah says so. But God never meant to say so. But this is the way I understood. This is the way it should be. So what when we say that the Yerushalayim was destroyed because people interpreted the Torah wrongly, that the idea was that you learn, but you learn the opposite. And what happened eventually? You're a religious person with all these problems. The problem that in my community that I have is not those who are not that they are religious and not religious. Those who think that they are religious don't think they are not religious. This is my problem with them. And all this pretending and all this hypocrisy of pretending what they are not. And I have many stories, but I don't think it's going to give us good energy about how people can be very, very corrupted in their thinking but everything is under the Torah. From the story of the student and the master, it's a different way of thinking. It's not that you are doing it mistakenly, it's that you are doing purposely, using your knowledge to become a bad person. And this, and everything is under the frame of the Torah, this is the concept of the Torah talks in Maseret Sanhedrin of Ben Sorer U'Moreh. A child that is not a good child, it has to be killed, lo aleinu, before he made a sin. What was his problem? He's drinking kosher wine, he's eating food, kosher food, but without control. But everything is kosher. We have this concept in our days. Every year on Pesach, before Pesach, I get new surprises. This year I saw already kosher lePesach bagel already. Last year it was kosher lePesach pasta and blintzes, and now it's kosher lePesach. We are just waiting for kosher lePesach bread and challah and finish with Pesach. But you will tell me it's kosher lePesach, but it's treif, because the concept of Pesach is the opposite. What do we say? No. This is Pesach. Sach nechinit. And in Israel, I was in Israel a week ago. There is a big debate between the rabbis about the wigs that women are wearing today. If the purpose of the wig is to make the make the woman more humble, or they say that sometimes the women they look nicer with the wig than with their own hair. So where are the limits? But you say yeah, but it's not a hair. It's natural 100%, but it's not her hair. And so all these debates of the small things to put the point, and it's a very, very sensitive point. When is the will of Hashem? And where is your interpretation that you're like, and where are the limits? And this is the idea of Lo Charve Yerushalayim, Ela She'emidu Dvarim, Al Din Torah. Because, as I told you, if you're missing the essence of Torah, if you're missing the direction of Torah, the learning can go against us. Every house, every family, every small home is a temple. The Gemara calls the temple the house of Avraham, Yitzchak, v'Yaakov. And Yerushalayim is going to be built when each of our families, of our homes, is going to be stronger, more spiritual. And since I came to America 2 days ago, I am blessed with telephones with people with a lot of marriage problems based on lack of direction. He got married because everybody is getting married, and they have children because it's come. We don't have to be genius to have children. But they don't know how to live the life. So they are fighting like dogs and cats, and their parents come to help them. It's become even a better or so. And it's one thing, the lack of direction. So what do you want by the end of the day? So if you really want to focus of really rebuild Beit HaMikdash and the temple, start with your own homes.
So where people should get other half from?
What?
Where people should get other half from?
If they don't come to today, we make a class very late on Saturday night for this purpose, for young couples to come and to learn. But if you feel it's more important to go to a restaurant, nowadays there is no Yirat Shamayim. It's become too, and there are enough classes, right? My colleagues, rabbis, and Baruch Hashem, there is Torah in our community, Baruch Hashem. But if you don't look for it, you won't get it. But the point is how to make your house stronger. If you really want to be ready for the fast of Tisha B'Av, and maybe to cancel it, You have tonight to go to be nicer to your husband, nicer to your wife, to your children, to your parents, to people around, to your neighbors. These small things, to build your own house, not to argue, not to fight. I remember a young couple came to me and said, Rabbi, my kids are all the time fighting. I say, because they see the other kids fighting, so they're fighting too. Yes, they talk about the parents I was talking. Yes. So when you're childish, and you say, and child become childish, and when you're losing the respect in the house, and the kavod in the house, and I know that the nature of women is to complain as a kind of communication, which is good. But you have to learn not to complain so much.
No, the men start also complaining.
It's contagious. It's contagious. It's contagious. Somebody has to start and the smarter has to stop. So who is smarter? You'll decide in your house, each of you. And they you talk about the men. The men they don't complain, but they like to demand the rights of being the and it's and of course it's wonderful that the husband should lead the house, but they have big problems with control freakers. And no, welcome controlling issues. I give you, I take from you, this, that, all this kind of. There is a nice couple in our community. They're fighting once a week from Sunday to Friday, Baruch Hashem. They don't have no stops, so they have savings. About $30,000-$40,000, God bless them. And they put it in a suitcase. They don't trust the bank, don't trust, no. So whenever there is a fight, the husband takes the suitcase.
They start to travel.
And they start to travel. So he comes to me with a suitcase. I say, what is the suitcase? So I'm the boss of the house. I say, you're a control. There's something in your brain. I say, no, she has to know, doesn't respect me. So we have to know that to prepare for Tisha B'Av is to take all these control issues and all these complaining things and all this low self-esteem that God blessed us with so much, Baruch Hashem, B'Lai Nara, that it's, and all this, and put it aside and try to build a normal home. And you're going to see that every small home that it's this is what we say to bring the Mashiach. We think about the Mashiach will come and we talk about something international, global. Leave the global to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. You try it with the local, and believe me, the local is local. Okay. It's very difficult. But make your own house, your own children, your own family. Be nice to them. And the way the wife has to respect her husband when he comes home is the way, at least, that she has to go to shopping. Is before she goes to shopping, she has to dress for 15-20 minutes because she has to see the teller over there, or the cashier. Her husband is more important. But anyway, the husband, he comes home, there is one of my Rashi Yeshivot, when he used to come home, he used to fix his clothing. So we told him, why you say that it's your house is like Beta Knesset, it's like the synagogue, it's like a small temple, because there is Shechina in the house. So when you go to the temple, you check yourself, so you go home, the same thing. So if you're going to make your house more spiritual and more clean, no cursing, Baruch Hashem, there is something in our culture that cursing is a part of our Zdravitsa and Shechina, no, it's a good morning and they start to curse. And it's like the Birkot HaShachar, Modeh Ani Lefanecha, and they start with not to curse in the house, not to curse yourself, not to curse other people, the children. And then don't be surprised when the kids become so well. If you're going to work on these small issues and not to complain next to your children, because you teach them. You teach them what is the... Many years ago, my wife, she wrote an article, and until now, my student reminds to me that the article is called How to Start a Fight. Как начинается война? And they say that one of the the children, he got a question, how war starts. So he came to ask his mother, and she was, guest has to come, her mother-in-law is coming, her sister-in-law is coming, she's in the kitchen, he say, Mama, I have to make homework, how war starts. She say, your father is lying over there in the salon, in the sofa, and the bizdelnik says, don't be up on my girl. He went to her and she say, Mother says she's very busy and you are now in unemployment, so you can maybe you can help me. So he say, go tell to your mother. He was watching an important soccer game. He said, go tell to your mother, your lazy mother, she instead of giving me our job, I was working so hard, so she should help you. And he went 2-3 times, and every time the blessing become more and more juicy. And then when he came back to his mother in the third time, she said, okay, how can I say, my mother, now I know how far. I learned without it how war starts. And this is the real, to build Beit HaMikdash, to build a temple, it goes with the essence of Torah, to be able to love somebody else beside yourself. And it's a big thing. So if you love your friends, if you love your wife, husband, children, then you can slowly understand what is the whole direction of our Torah is. God should bless us that by next Saturday night, instead of morning of Yerushalayim, we are going to celebrate the preparation to go to Israel. Hopefully we won't fight for tickets, then the Mashiach will not come another few minutes. Somebody asked me in the morning in the synagogue, why we don't build Beit HaMikdash? Why just go inside Yerushalayim and build Beit HaMikdash? I told him, we're going to start to argue who is going to build it now. It's going to be Hasidic, Ashkenazi, Sephardi. Who is going to be the contractor? Another 2,000 years to go. So Hashem is going to be the third one, you're ready from heaven, no arguments. Shavua Tov.